So what happened to you and your family when you first arrived, aside from you becoming very ill?
They separated women from men, different barracks, but the same compound. And after a week or two, another transport came, a big transport from Warsaw. Another few hundred people, who now were about 1,000 people in our enclosure in the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp, found out the name of the concentration camp. We were the first one to open up the camp. Our group was the first one to open Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. It's supposed to have been for prisoners of war, but they decided to put us first in there. And became a concentration camp for tortures and, you know, Jews and others that were prisoners of the German beautiful Vaterland. We were there until an incident happened where an inspection from Berlin came to inspect how well the camp is run. And our representative, the Jewish representative, supposed to give a report. So he stood outside the barracks. Everybody was in the barracks, except each barrack had a representative. And I forget the name. While the Gestapo was passing through, and our representative was giving the report, one of the Gestapo men stepped out and he said, "Your name is not so and so. We went to the same law school in Berlin." So he recognized him, and the Gestapo sat in the office of the camp office, looking through all the papers of the 1,000 people, 1,000 prisoners, through, and they found 500 illegal false papers. And they put up a list with the name that they found on the, we didn't know what kind of a list this is. We thought they were being picked out to go to Switzerland to be exchanged for prisoners of war. And people that had money on them, or gold or whatever valuables, tried to exchange places with those people on the list. There were fights. Two brothers, one took the bait, two doctors, and the other one didn't want to go. So he didn't want to be exchanged. So he exchanged places with someone else, and we found out the 500 people were loaded on a train and sent straight to Auschwitz, to the gas chambers, because they found out that those papers were false papers. Where did they get the papers, the foreign papers, all those people with Guatemalan papers and all these South American papers? From Gestapo in Warsaw. The families that were in England and the United States wanted to save the families that were in Europe. So they sent certificates, documents to save them. But those people didn't live anymore. They were killed. So the Gestapo went into business. They were selling the papers for thousands of dollars. People that had the money got the paper from the Gestapo, and they joined our group. Well, we are now 500 people, because the other 500 went to straight to the gas chambers. How we found out is the train came back to Bergen-Belsen with all the luggage that those people had. That's how we found out where they went.
Can you describe how people educated the younger children in the camp?
Yes, this was our resistance. There were students, university students, imprisoned with us. And for a piece of bread, you could learn English, you could learn French, math, even architecture, as I did. The boards from the bunk beds that held up the straw mattress served as my notebook. We had little pieces of pencils that everybody collected. When those pieces of pencils, the stubs, ran out, we used charcoal. I was learning how to be an architect from an architect that was imprisoned with us. It was very interesting. And that's how I resisted. We had songs that they taught us, you know, the university students. Because learning kids under the German rule was forbidden, under penalty of death. And although we were in a separate camp called Sonderlager, it means special camp, we were still under their rule, under their thumb, and under their whim.
Now, what did it mean to be in Sonderlager?
Sonderlager was especially with people with special papers, foreign papers.
And it was a section of
Bergen-Belsen? This was a section of Bergen-Belsen, a special compound.
So what was life like in Bergen-Belsen for you and your family?
It was torture, because first of all, we were given rations, a slice of bread for in the morning and a slice of bread in the evening. Black coffee, if they gave us coffee, was black coffee, a cup of black coffee, and soup for lunch. They brought in big kettles, drums, but we found pieces of mice sometimes. Everybody was running around with a tail. Here it is. that they collected garbage in the kitchen, military kitchen. They threw it into the soup, and that's what they cooked. Anything that they could put their hands on, you know, leftovers for us, Everybody, you know, they gave us a military bread. It was a loaf of bread, hard like a rock, black bread, and we had to cut ourselves to divide it between the people in the barrack. So I have a painting, the rationing of the food in the barrack. We picked one man with a very steady hand and a sharp knife that cut very thin slices. And everybody stood around the table watching the crumb shouldn't fall away because it belongs to this piece of bread. And we created a scale of pieces of wood, strings, and cardboard. So nobody should be gypped with a real crumb.
You talk about hope a lot, and how that's a big contributor.
We lived with hope because we saw the Allied planes coming over Germany every day and night. And we hoped that they would drop a bomb on the German barracks, but they never did. And they knew about the camp. Once they had a dogfight over our camp, and a little girl was hit with a bullet. The bullet was from a machine gun, from a plane machine gun. It was so long. So she got hit in the head, just grazed her head. Boy, she was lucky. We had hope, and nothing was very promising, because we saw the American planes and British planes being shut down. So we figured it's not so easy. It's not so easy for those soldiers. That's why it was such a surprise at the time of liberation.